thank you all very much for coming out tonight. It's good to see you. I want to say a special thank you to the choir. We just had a very, very long practice. Looked like we all got in a water gun fight, don't it? But it's really, really hot here, but we got a lot of practice done, a lot of recital done, and it's honoring to the Lord, and we'll thank you for your time there, okay? Well, we're all going to stand. We're going to sing all three verses of I'll Fly Away, and that's in the front of the book, guys. There's no number to that, but I know that you're ready for it. Three verses, we'll all stand. I'll Fly Away, okay? Brother Stan Edwards, sir, to ask the Lord to bless the service tonight in a special way, please, sir.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated, and we are glad you're here tonight. Well, we sing that song, I'll Fly Away. Boy, that's an old-time favorite, ain't it? I'll Fly Away, and in a lot of churches. And like I said, when I first got saved in the church that I went to, my home church for all the years until I came over here, back then, the song leader, and I could tell you his name, and I'll just say this, it was Shouting Charlie. Everybody called him Shouting Charlie, Charlie Bishop. He was our song leader back at that time, and he went over later and pastored over in Easley before he passed away. But Charlie Bishop, we'd sing that song, Amazing Grace. We'd sing, When the Roll is Called Up Yonder, and I'll Fly Away. And I thought that was the only songs you sang in church, because that's all I ever heard. And how many people remember Wesley Grant? Wesley Grant, many people remember Wesley Grant, old black preacher out of Asheville, North Carolina. And boy, he'd had a TV program and on Channel 13 way back in the day, if you remember that, in the 70s and 80s. And Wesley, he came to our church one time. And a home church, and he was singing and preaching for us and everything. And his wife, Hun, she played the piano. And his son, Lewis, he was a DJ up at 106.9 out of Black Mountain. And they were all there singing, and he sang that song, I'll Fly Away. And whenever they were singing, Wesley would be singing part of it, and Hun and Lewis would be singing the other part, and Wesley would hold out, and they're back in the background saying, fly away, fly away, fly away. Y'all ever heard that one? If you listen, you'll get to hear them in heaven one day. Maybe they'll be in the heavenly choir. And he could hold that out. He could hold that out forever. And I mean, you'd be sitting on a pew trying to breathe for him. And they would just hold it out. What a blessing it was. One day we will fly away. That's going to be a reality one day. Hey, it was good to see Brother Ken back in church this morning. I know he's still trying to get his strength back. And that took a lot. But he wrote us a card and said, thanks to my brothers and sisters in Christ. I want to thank you for keeping me in your prayers. This is an unusual time with the surgery and recovery. I want to thank you for the food, the phone calls, the texts. It was very encouraging to see all the outpouring of love. Still have a way to go, but things are improving. And I want to thank God for guiding the doctors and the nurses who were remarkable. God answered prayer. Certainly, I have experienced this firsthand. Never give up. God always shows up and miracles happen. I love you all and thank you for your kindness and prayers. Pray for one another. Love God. Love one another. Thank God every day you wake up. Be grateful, large or small, for everything. Take time to learn each other and love deeper than ever thought you could. That amazing grace is real. The eternal mercy is real. And miracles really happen. God is my strength. So God be the glory. Ken Wallace. And boy, when you go through what he went through, and you know that you're just one heartbeat away from death is what you are. And so we appreciate the Lord blessing him. I failed to mention this morning, Brother Buddy Haley, he had his surgery this week and everything went well. So he's at home recovering. If you can remember them in prayer, that Lord will help them get back and get back in church and get their health and strength back. And this coming Wednesday night, again, we're going to be doing the visitation. We'll start at 7:30. And if you can come out, like I say, there's something for everyone to do that'll come out. And this coming Wednesday night, because Jeremiah's gone, he sent me a text and said we want to do the children's program. So we need someone to watch the children, do some things with children on Wednesday night at 7:30 while some adults are out knocking on doors. And then we're going to have Jeff's going to make us some hot dogs and everything. So we're going to have some good hot dogs and everything Wednesday night. And so, hey, Brother Jeff, I learned how to cook a new hot dog when I went to camp this week. The guy making the hot dogs, the wieners and everything, I said, you want me to get them out for you to pack? And he said, well, I cut them. I said, what do you do? You mean cut them? He just laid a knife across and kind of swirled around like a spiral, swirled around everything. He said, it wouldn't crack open that way. I like them cracking open, don't you? Yeah, I like it. You know, when they crack open, I like them that way. So I cut every one of those weenies that way. The way he said, I just laid a blade on it, went across that way. So I did help a little bit. But Jeff can do them the way he wants to. But we'll be here at 7:30, and we'll have some drinks and all that, food, go out, knock on doors. And there's something again, like I said, we bought some more things this week. So some people can sit around and stay here and do more of those packages up for us to hang on the doors. We bought some more stuff this week, and we can finish up those packages that were not finished. So that'll be this Wednesday night at 7:30, something for everyone to do, and try to get out and hang on those hangers on some more doors this week. And then don't forget this coming Sunday morning, Sunday night. We've got a special day Sunday morning. We're practicing in the choir tonight. We just did an impromptu thing and started doing some songs and everything for Sunday morning. So we're going to try to do something special for y'all on Sunday morning. Patriotic songs, and so we're hoping to be a blessing. And then Sunday night, 7 o'clock, down in the gym, and we'll be down there, and we're going to have hot dogs, hamburgers, we'll have fun, we're going to have games, we'll have all this stuff, and we hope you can come, be a part of it, and then at about dark, we'll start shooting some fireworks. Now, I understand that Tabernacle is doing the same thing. Our firework display is going to be better than theirs. Yes, sir. Ours is going to be better. Yeah, I want y'all to film it, and we're going to compete with them, okay? I'm going to tell Brother Logan, we beat y'all. We got y'all. Y'all may have more people, but we have better fireworks and everything. All right, Joe, come and listen to the song.
All right, well, I'll stand. Jesus saves all four verses. We'll have a time of fellowship after that fourth verse. If you have an offering, you bring that down during that time of fellowship, okay? All four verses, we have heard the joyful sound. First, we have heard the joyful sound. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Spread the tidings all around. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Bear the news to every land. Climb the steeps and cross the waves. Onward, this our Lord's command. Jesus saves. About the battleship. Turn your seats, you can be seated. And I told Pastor, didn't I have a third congregation tonight? My little 10-year-old, I'll try not to cry, I asked if she could sing tonight. And before I could really tell her yes or no, when we got here tonight, she didn't run over to Sam and run over to Preacher, and she said she was singing tonight. So I didn't have a chance to tell her yes or no. And so if Christian does not record this, her dad's going to be so mad at her. So I'll get ready to do that. But little Jenny wants to sing for us tonight. We appreciate her doing that. Red microphone should be on, guys, okay?
Thank you, Jeannie. You did a great job there. I really do appreciate that. That's a wonderful song. And this past week at the Mission Down, we had orientation all week long during the day from 8:30 in the morning till 3 o'clock in the afternoon in classes and all. And then at night at 7 o'clock, we'd have a service in the auditorium there. And one night, Fred Kindheart leading the singing, and Fred wanted all of us and people who could sing different languages and knew different languages to sing that song. And I think that's what it was, wasn't it? What can wash away my sin? So Janice and I got with Robbie and Kathy. Now, we're just in the congregation, but when it got to when he'd say Portuguese, we sang that verse in Portuguese. And we heard it in Portuguese, and we heard it in Spanish, we heard it in Indonesian, we heard it in French. And I think we heard it in English too, didn't we? Did we hear it in English? I think we did. I forget all the languages that were there, the missionaries that were there this past week, and all the languages. And I'm probably going to miss one. But it sounded real good to be able to hear it in that. And I know one year at our missions conference here, whenever we got to a certain point, I had different people in the church to stand up and say John 3:16 in their language. And Sister Dorothy got to say it in Korean. And we got to hear John 3:16 in a lot of different languages that year. And and one thing that I'm trying to remember who it was. One of them that sang it. And it was a language that hasn't been spoken as far as the Lord Jesus Christ. They didn't even have that Jesus. They didn't have a name for him. They had God, but they didn't have Jesus. And so whenever they wrote that song, they just put in there, since it wasn't a word Jesus in their language, they just put Jesus in there. So whenever that one group, whoever it was, I can't remember, it might have been Indonesian. Honduras. Yeah, okay, Mosquito language that. Brother Gene Trask, he's down in Honduras there, and I'm talking about, when you're talking about Honduras, I'm not talking about Spanish Honduras, I'm talking about up the river, way up the river, Honduras, and he's in the backwoods. If there's ever been a missionary in the backwoods, he is in the backwoods. And I got a confession to make, but they did, and I think Gene helped translate that, didn't he? And he translated that song. He just put, they don't have the name for Jesus. He put the name Jesus in there. So whenever they sang it, that's what it was. And Fred brought that to our attention. And I had to confess to the mission this week. We stayed in a hotel down there. And every morning, Janice is not a breakfast eater, and neither is Kathy Smith. So me and Robbie, we met every morning in the lobby of the hotel. We went to eat breakfast. And that first day there on Tuesday morning, we got there Monday afternoon. Tuesday morning, we met down for breakfast. And when we eating breakfast, here comes Robin Trask. And Jean doesn't eat breakfast. And so she sat down beside me. And she ate breakfast with us, me and Robbie. Then Deborah Harrison came in with her three boys, and they ate with us and all from Africa. And so on Tuesday night, I told Deborah, or I told Robin, I said, look, Robin, I said, we're going to have to quit meeting like this. I said, people are getting suspicious. And I said, tomorrow we're going to have to cut it off after breakfast. That's it. We can't meet like this anymore. And on Tuesday, I think it was Thursday night, I reckon, or Wednesday night after the service, all of us men sitting at a table. We had popcorn and I forget, some ice cream and all that. And then all the ladies were sitting. And so I heard those ladies laughing. That's what they were talking about. And it's what Robin said. She said, I would not have done that if I didn't look up to Brother Danny as my father. I said, I'm not that old. I am not that old. And so anyhow, we had a good time of fellowship. 1 John chapter number 1 tonight. 1 John chapter number 1, had good liberty this morning preaching. Now tonight, it's going to be a little bit different again. I'm going to be kind of introductory things on 1 John. And we're entitling this, Defending Our Convictions of Who Christ Is, His Deity. And John's having to do that. Now, sometimes we see a verse in the Bible, we just quote that verse. We don't really know why that verse is in the Bible. If you go back to Philippians, you don't have to turn there, but if you go in Philippians chapter 4, Paul said this right here, but my God shall supply all your need according to his riches in Christ Jesus. You know, and that's what Paul said. Now, we just quote that verse all the time. Well, God's going to supply our need. Sometimes we don't know why that verse is there. If you go back to previous verses, Paul had a need, and the church had a need, and that church of Philippi met that need, and Paul said, since you met our need financially, you have created a need in your place, and he said, my God will supply that need that you created because you helped somebody else in their need. And every verse in the Bible is there for a reason. 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John is in the Bible for a reason, and John wrote them, as I mentioned last week. In these verses that John, he is going to the third generation. And I'm going to say this again. By the third generation in any church, in any of God's timing, by the third generation, there needs to be a revival, a spiritual revival. There needs to be a reviving for everyone. And you know, like the mother and father in the first generation, John here. And he says, look what he says in verse number 1. That which was from the beginning, you see that? Which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon, and our hands have handled of the word of life. Now that's what Paul or John is saying. He said, everything we saw, we touched it, we were there, we saw it with our own eyes, we listened to it. And so everything they had because of the Lord Jesus Christ was conviction. The next generation, whenever they came along, it just became a belief. And then the next generation, the third generation that John is speaking to here, if you look in your Bible and if you find out, the book of 1st, 2nd, 3rd John was written for the book of Jude, which it comes right for Revelation. Book of Jude was written around 66 A.D. The book 1st, 2nd, 3rd John was written, and Revelation around 90 A.D. And so John is reaching a generation that no one else had reached. Paul didn't reach them. He wasn't around. Peter wasn't around. None of them reached this generation that John is talking to now. And what he's trying to do is convince them. You know, to us, it was conviction. To your mom and dad, it was a belief because they just followed us. And then now you just take it as an opinion. In other words, it could be changed. Somebody can change your mind. Somebody can convince you of that. Whereas the other ones, it was conviction. And so that's why John is writing these epistles here to tell them. And he talks about the false prophet. He talks about the false religions. He talks about how can you tell if it's a false religion or not? Whoever does not confess that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, Jesus is God in the body of flesh, they're a false cult. They're a false cult, and that's what John is saying. So we have a lot of different people, things here. So John is writing these things. When he wrote his book, the Gospel of John, he was reminding everybody then of the deity of the Lord Jesus Christ. He really was. If you look in the book of John, he talks about God. He talks about Jesus being the Son of God, God in the body of flesh. I believe it is John chapter 1, verse number 1 says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. And the Word was God. So John was talking about Jesus Christ being God in the body of flesh. Now, you'd be amazed at the people today that don't believe that. There's universities, I'm talking about so-called Christian universities and Bible colleges, that whenever people come out, they come out not believing anymore in the inspiration of the Bible. They come out not believing anymore the virgin birth of the Lord Jesus Christ, and that's what John is defending here. And they do not even believe that Jesus is God in the body of flesh. And so we'll look at a couple of these tonight. And again, you could take either one of these sects of people, and you can go to Google, and you can Google it yourself, and you'll find out that in the first century of Christianity, these people existed, and these beliefs, these sects, they existed. I think about Paul, and I think about the disciples, and I think about the Lord Jesus Christ. They dealt with the Pharisees, didn't they? They dealt with the Pharisees, and they dealt with the Sadducees, and they dealt with the scribes. They dealt with all these religious leaders of their day. John here is dealing with a different type of people. We don't even see him talking about the Pharisees, I don't think. I didn't go through here this week and look, but I don't think he even deals with the Pharisees or the Sadducees. And you see, the Sadducees and the Pharisees were almost the same type of people, except one believed in the resurrection and the other one didn't. Brother Clyde Billingsley, old Southern Baptist preacher that I hung around with many years of my life, in my early years of Christianity, and he is a great preacher, and he's one of the old Southern Baptist preachers that stood, and he wasn't a liberal. But I'll just say this right here. He said this about the Sadducees. He said here's how he described them, and I never forgot that. He said they don't believe in the resurrection. He said that's why they're sad, you see. You see that? You can remember the Sadducees by the fact that they don't believe in the resurrection. And Paul said this right here. If I have hope in this life only, I am of all men most miserable. And so if you don't believe in the resurrection, we have no hope for tomorrow, do we? We'd have no hope for anything. And everything we do today, it just falls on deaf ears, and we're doing it for naught, for no reason whatsoever. So when we look at this, and I believe that John, he wrote these three epistles to remind the people also, not only of the deity of Christ, but also his humanity. His humanity. God will say this, Jesus Christ was God 100%, and he was man 100%. He was born of the flesh. And in the flesh, let's say, not of the flesh, but he was born through a woman. And we know that. But he took upon him the body, the form of a man, and flesh he took upon him. He was 100% God. He was 100% man. He was the God-man. That's who the Lord Jesus Christ was. And so you come to the book of John, and you're going to find out that these people nowadays, they at that time, they didn't really believe in that. Let me give you one of them. If you want to write this down, and I wrote this down, Ebionites. Ebionites, E-B-I-O-N-I-T-E-S. You can look them up. And this is what it says about them, their main doctrine. They denied the deity of the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's what John's having to deal with. That's what he's having to deal with. Verse number 2, he said, "For the life was manifest as we have seen it, and bear witness and show unto you that eternal life which was with the Father and was manifested unto us." Verse number 3, "That which we have seen and heard declare we unto you, that ye also may have fellowship," or have fellowship with us, "and truly our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. And these things write we unto you, that your joy may be full." So here's a group of people that's slipping into the church, and people slip in all the time. Let me tell you, one of the most dangerous groups of people that tries to slip in our church, there's another group today. I've read a little bit about him. I've heard a little bit about him. And they're called, I think if I'm not mistaken, Andersonites. Andersonites. And it's some guy, he's some preacher, supposed to be a fundamental, independent Baptist preacher, and his people are slipping into our churches and trying to divert our gospel. They're called Andersonites. If I'm not mistaken, that's what they're called, Andersonites. I don't go for all that stuff. I don't care about it, but I've heard about it. And when people talk about it, I try to check up just a little bit to see what's going on. And they're slipping. Now, and I see people on social media all the time. Oh, yeah, we had a group of them come in our church. They try to tear our church up. They try to go against the doctrine. This guy is of the devil. This guy, he is not. But he calls himself an independent Baptist. And so you got these groups that slip in. Another group that tries to slip in our churches today is the Calvinists. The Calvinists. Now, I'm gonna make a statement here, because I don't know for sure, but I was told this week. Now, please take this for what it's worth, okay? And I don't doubt it, because it came from a very reliable source, and I don't doubt it. But 5 years ago, we were back down in Brazil, and we went to the churches that we either helped start or we started, and we preached in those churches. In the last church that we helped start, the pastor that's over that church now, we started in his garage, in his house back in 1990. And then the Lord blessed us. We rented a storefront building. Then we bought a piece of property. And then later on, we built a building. We came back in 97. Fernando Martins took the work. And now he resigned the work to go out to another city, which is a university city where the doctors and all that and all them, the medical university where they study. And he started a fundamental Baptist church there and doing a great job. We sent him some money a couple of years ago, if y'all remember. We raised some money and sent him $8,000 for the work and for the building and all that in there. And then his brother-in-law took over, the man who we started his garage, took over this work now. And I said something to another missionary. I won't say this. I'll say it to Robbie Smith. I was eating one day breakfast, and I said something to Robbie about the church. And it's what he said. He said, "Brother Dan," he said, I don't know for sure, but he said, "I'm pretty much sure that they have let Calvinism slip into that church." And that's the church that I started back in 1990. The Lord allowed us to start back in 1990. Now, I don't doubt it. Now, I'm going to say this reason why. Now, this right here can get you in trouble, this next reason why. But I don't mind saying it. Because his son, Ulysses, he was his oldest son, some years ago he came here to study at Bob Jones University. Now, I'm not against Bob Jones University by any stretch of the imagination, but they do have a lot of professors that are Calvinists in their university. Dr. Bob Jones, Dr. Bob Jones Jr., back in, let's say, my son Nathan graduated 03, was it, honey? 03 he graduated that year at the Bible conference. They played a 25-year capsule, time capsule. They had a cassette tape in there that Bob Jones Jr. wrote or preached a message, and they played it that year at the Bible conference in that year in March of 2003. And he said three things would be the destruction of Bob Jones University and the downfall of Bob Jones University. And he said one of them, I can't remember one, it didn't really matter, but he said number one, he said there's a translation of the Bible. And I believe that's a big battle over there in their Bible department. You know, because you got a lot of men in their Bible department who promotes the ESV, NASV and all the other versions, and they'll try to battle you on the King James Version. So he said, the Bible version. Now, and I believe that's truthful. So 2003 was how many years ago? That was 20 years ago almost, right? Next year will be 20 years. So 25 years before that. So you're talking about almost 45 years ago that this was spoken when he preached this message. And they got the time capsule out after his death, and that's what they preached. He said, number two, Calvinism. Calvinism. And there's a lot. My son Daniel played baseball with a lot of them who were on staff over there and did things. And I know they all went to Presbyterian churches. And when Nathan was studying there at Bob Jones, one of the professors in his class said, the sad thing about Bob Jones University is the fact that they are too Baptistic in their belief. So what I'm saying is, this young man from our church no doubt got it. And see, here's the thing. When he came here to study, he never darkened the doors of Zion Hill Baptist Church. He never came to our church. He went to one that holds to Calvinistic doctrines. And so I don't doubt the fact that he went back and his daddy is unlearned. As far, his daddy's a banker, his daddy's a pastor of the church, his daddy's a smart man, but in the scripture he's unlearned when it comes down to different ideologies and all that and different things. And so what I'm saying is, we got to be careful in our churches not to let things like that slip in, and that's what these Ebionites did. And not only did they say that, they said he was just another created being. Now that sounds almost like the Jehovah's Witnesses, don't it? He was just another created being. And then they said, this is what they say about him also, and I looked this up on Google, because you're not going to find these texts in the Bible. But you're going to look them up on Google, and it said he was adopted as Son of God because he was. They just said he was a natural born son of Joseph and Mary. So that's what they say. That's who John is fighting against here, and that's who he's talking about. Then you have the Docetists, and this is what they believe. They deny the humanity of Christ. One denies the deity of Christ, and one denies the humanity of Christ. They believe that Jesus Christ had not come in flesh. He had not come in flesh. John said it like this, and in the book of John, he said, we beheld his flesh. Did he not? He became flesh. We beheld his glory. Look real quick. John chapter 1. And we can see this in John chapter number 1. I just mentioned that John said in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Now, can I stop and say this? Not everybody at Bob Jones University believes this. I'm just telling you, there's certain people who do, and certain sects in there do, and they try to spread their stuff. And so, I mean, I was at Tabernacle Bible College, and while I was there teaching in Tabernacle, there's a group of people who were spreading Calvinism in there. They try to slip in. And so we got to be careful, and that's what John said. John just saying, look, preach Christ. Preach the Lord Jesus Christ. Don't try to go after all these beliefs and everything. John chapter 1, this is what he said according to his humanity of the Lord Jesus Christ. John 1, verse number 14, and the Word was made flesh. You see, the Docetists, they don't believe that he was fleshly Christ, that he was a carnal man. And he said, the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. We beheld his glory as the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. So what John is defending in 1 John chapter number 1 and 2, 3, 4, and 5, and in 2 John and 3 John, he's defending the fact that Jesus Christ is deity and that Jesus Christ was a human. He was God and he was human. And this is how they believe. They believe that he had not come into flesh, and that they taught that he was some kind of, listen now, this is what this group believed in. They believed that he was some kind of phantom. He was a ghost. He did not really exist. He was not a real person. That's what they believe. They said his sufferings of the Lord Jesus Christ, they said his sufferings were just apparent sufferings. They were not real sufferings. But I want to tell you something. He died on the cross, and it was an open shame when he died for our sins on the cross. You say, preacher, people don't believe that. They did in John's day in 90 AD, and they believe things like that today. People still do believe things like that. Then there was the Corinthians, not the Corinthians, okay, the Corinthians. There were the Corinthians. They denied the union of the two natures. So you have one that doesn't believe in the deity of Christ, that he was God in the body of flesh. They have the other one that doesn't believe that he was natural born man, that he was just some kind of phantom, he was some kind of ghost and all that.
And then you have this other group that didn't believe that the union, they believed that, yeah, he was God, maybe he was flesh, but they didn't believe they came together. But the Bible tells us that he is the God-man. He is the fullness of the Godhead bodily. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost. So that's what the Bible teaches us. So they believe that the human and divine natures never came together. That's what they believe. They taught that the real Christ, descended upon a man by the name of Jesus. That's what their belief was. They believe that, yeah, there was a man named Jesus, but he was not the Christ. He was not the Messiah. It's just that whenever he was here on this earth, that's almost like spiritism, man. I'm telling you, I lived in Brazil and we dealt with spiritism. And there was a doctor in Brazil called Dr. Fritz. Dr. Fritz. Now, I don't say this a lot, but this guy was a national phenomenon. He was a doctor, and there were several of them along the way. When I say Dr. Fritz was a German doctor from 300 years ago that embodied came into their bodies when they did surgeries, these spiritist guys, spiritist doctors. Now, I have observed in videos of these doctors, and whenever they get possessed of that spirit of Dr. Fritz, they would talk and mumbo jumbo. I mean, it's like they were just out of their mind. It's like they were being embodied by a spirit, an evil spirit. And I saw him do surgeries on people that had masses on their head, brain tumors or whatever, and the only thing he would use was a hammer and chisel. No anesthesia, no kind of stitches, and there was never a drop of blood. And that's satanic, buddy. That's the thing. And this people that he's dealing with, John's dealing with, are the same type people. And so these doctors in Brazil, and each one of them died a tragic death that were possessed by this doctor. I lived in Brazil, I'm telling you this. The guy that I bought a car from, these three brothers, Alaiges, and they had the best cars in town. They had more than the dealership. They had more cars than the dealership, and they were good guys. And I went to one of them one day, you know, one of them, the crazy one, the three brothers, always a crazy brother, right? One of them just jokes around all the time, and he wasn't the serious one. And I was there talking to him one day. He pulled his shirt off. He said, Pastor, look here on my back. And he showed me where he had been operated on by that doctor that I'm talking about. And he said, what do you think about that? I said, well, the Bible says Satan can be transformed into the angel of light, and he's a deceiver. And I said, it's satanic. Now, they were all Catholics. These guys were all Catholic. And I'm going to tell you this. Catholicism and Spiritism walk hand in hand. They walk hand in hand. They're Catholic by day. They're Spiritist by night. In the countries, in those third world countries where the Catholic Church dominates, in the city of São Paulo, at the center of the city, and I would take sometimes a subway from where I live over there to change money downtown. And sometimes I'd get off at the Estação Station Sé, S-E, S-E with a slash over it, Sé. And there they had the main Catholic church in downtown São Paulo. Up here was a regular church where they performed the masses and all that. In the basement was a Spiritist worship place. So I'm just telling them they walk hand in hand. People don't believe that, but I say, yes, they do. They walk hand in hand. And so we see these things, and hey, this has been in the church ever since the beginning. All these things that we see, people we hear about, and all these things. Listen, they said that, these people here, they said the Christ, the Messiah, came upon Jesus at birth, and then the day of his crucifixion left him. That's how they believe. So this is what John is having to deal with. He's having to talk about these things and deal with it. But John completely, in his book here, in his epistle, John completely destroys all these heresies. And there's a lot of heresies today, and John is trying to tell us, don't be deceived by these people coming into your church. And you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. And I believe if we understand the truth and study the truth of God's word, I don't think we, you know, when we hear the lie, the Bible talks about in Proverbs, Psalm Proverbs says the hear and ear and the see and eye, God hath made them both. When we hear the truth, we'll see the lie. We can see it whenever it's live. We know whenever something's not real coming in. But John, he destroys these things. Look in 1 John chapter 5, if you would. 1 John chapter 5. Here's what he's saying. And I'm just about finishing out. I'm not going to go long. I got several other things that we could talk about. But I'm just about finished because I'm almost finished with the introduction of what we're trying to say and where we're trying to get. And it's how John destroyed them. 1 John chapter 5. In verse number 10, look what it says. He that believeth on the Son of God hath the witness in himself. He that believeth not God hath made him a liar, because he believeth not the record that God gave of his Son. In other words, God is saying, this is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. Hear ye him. Now, on the day of his baptism, God said, when they heard the voice and the clouds rolled back, and he heard the voice saying, this is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. On the day of the Mount of Transfiguration, when Jesus was transfigured before the disciples there, three of the disciples there that day, or a few of them, whenever he was transformed, they heard a voice also, this is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. Hear ye him. In other words, we can take the words of Jesus and believe them as the truth. And so that's what John is saying here. He's saying, hey, If you don't believe what God said, if you don't believe the testimony that God gave of his own Son, you have made God a liar. You know, I'm going to tell you what the Bible says. Let every man be a liar and God be the truth. I'll take God's word over anybody's word, wouldn't you? I sure will. I'll take his word over anybody. Then look back in John chapter, 1 John 4. 1 John 4. And he's tearing these people up. He's ripping their face off. He's jerking their head off and spitting down their neck. That's pretty bad, ain't it? I mean, that's how he's doing it. He's ripping their head off so he can spit down their neck and say, see, I told you so. Brother Dean Hamby, he preached a great message this week. On Monday night down there, opened up the meeting. Boy, Brother Dean preached a wonderful message. He's a great preacher. And he preached in Psalm 46, God is our refuge. And boy, he brought out some great things in there. I don't have time to go through them all. But afterwards, you know, because there's three divisions in John, in Psalm number 46. There's three divisions. Each one of them ends with God is our refuge. And it says Selah. And it says Selah. And it says Selah. Now, if you go and study the Bible and ask people, what does that word Selah mean? You know, a lot of people don't even read it when they read Psalm. But it's an important word. And Dean said it means this. Somebody says it means that. The best definition I ever heard of Selah. Because what God is, or the psalmist is doing there, he's talking about what kind of a great God we have above all. He said, even though the earth be removed, even though the waters be removed and all that, we still have God as our refuge. No matter what happens in this world, no matter what happens to people around, God's still our refuge. That's what the psalmist is saying there to the devil and to the worldly crowd, that we still have a great God. You don't have that great God like we do. And if everything that we have goes away, we still have a great God. And that word Selah, the best definition I ever heard of it, was a commentary that I have in my study back here. He said, when you get to that word Selah here in Psalm 46, he said, what you want to do is stick out your tongue at the devil and say, what do you think about my God now? I think that's the best definition. What do you think about my God? You know, what do you think about that devil? I can stick my tongue out at you and I can make fun of you because my God's greater than you are. And so that's what John is trying to say here. We have a great God, and he's trying to refute them. John chapter 1 or 4, verse number 1. Beloved, 1 John 1 or 4, verse number 1. Beloved, believe not every spirit, but try the spirits whether they are of God, because many false prophets are gone out into the world. It's amazing what Baptist people will tell you they believe and what they've heard and what they've seen on TV or the radio. And there's a lot of preacher, radio, television evangelists that, man, I'm not going to call them the devil's work. I'm not going to say that. But they don't have the Spirit of God in them. And they're saying things contrary to what the Bible teaches just to get your almighty dollar. That's what they'll do. And so a lot of people, oh, preacher, what do you think about? Just like this guy, the Catholic in Brazil, said he was operated on by this Dr. Fritz. And he said, what do you think about that? And there's people, there's another church in Brazil about like the Church of Christ here that believes in water baptism for regeneration. And it's called the Congregação Cristã do Brasil, and they got a big. Church of Christ here because of their music and everything. It's only by the brass and all that. Most of them can play a trumpet or whatever. They don't have a piano and all that, guitars in their church. And some of them have visited our church. And one of them told me, he said, "Preacher, I was at a baptism one day, and he said this guy was limping. When he was limping with his leg and on a crutch and everything, he walked into the, because they had a public baptistry out there, he walked into the baptistry, got baptized, walked out straight and walking and everything. He said, "What do you think about that?" I said, "Devil has power. Baptism doesn't wash away anything. If it washed away our sins, when we drained the water, all the fish in the lake would be dead." You can say what you want to say, but I'm just telling you, this is what John's saying. Don't believe all the spirits that are out there. Don't believe everything's out there. Verse number 2, he said, "Hereby know you the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesses that Jesus Christ is come into flesh is of God. And every spirit that confesses not that Jesus Christ is come into flesh is not of God. And this is the spirit of Antichrist, whereof ye have heard that it was should come, and even now already is in the world." Verse number 4, "You're of God, little children, and have overcome them, because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world." Boy, John, there's just so much we can say here about 1 John. I mean, there's so much about this false stuff around. And I just believe we need to find what God would have us to do and what he would say. And then look in, if you would, real quick. Now, here's where we are. Here's where we stand. I always thought that my daddy was mean to Jehovah's Witnesses. And I thought my daddy was mean to the Mormons. And I thought my daddy was mean to false cults that would try to come. I remember as a little boy. Now, you got to remember, when I was about 5 years old, we got out of church. My daddy had been saved after the war. And when I was a little boy back in the, let's say, around 1960, 61, 62, somewhere along there, as a little boy playing in the creek and everything, here comes two guys down to there, and they want to know if I want to go be a part of their church. Man, I wanted to be a part of a church. You know, because I was 5 or 6 years old, 7, whatever. And I want to be a part of church. "Hey, can we go talk to your daddy?" I said, "Yeah, we live right up the road here." So we walked down through there, and we went up to daddy, and I went in the house, told my daddy to come out on the porch. And when daddy found out they were Mormons, he said, "Get off my property right now." And they said, "Well, sir," he said, "you ain't moving fast enough. Get off my property right now." I said, "Man, daddy, what are you doing? You mean these guys, they want to get me in church, and you mean to them?" My daddy understood the false prophets. He understood heresy, and he understood that. And he would just stomp his foot, and he said, "You ain't moving fast enough for me. You get off my property right now." Now, let me tell you about the Mormons. Here's how they do. We're working in Brazil. And when we see the American Mormons, was it a bowling alley, or was it a shopping center or something, we'd see them in town at a grocery store or something. And they would come and talk to us, and we would talk to them as Americans. We didn't talk to them as brothers and sisters in Christ, because we're not. And because they believe that you got to have Jesus Christ, you got to have the Bible plus the Mormon, Book of Mormons. They believe you got to have Jesus Christ plus Joseph Smith. Let me tell you what salvation is. It's grace plus nothing and minus nothing. For by grace are you saved through faith. You don't have to add anything else to it. But here's what they would do. They would get our names and everything. And then they'd find out members in our church. And they would go to members in our church to have Bible studies. You know what they're trying to do? Confuse them. And when I found this out, I went to one of our members one night. I've been missed a couple of times. And I went to their house and I said, "Is there any problem here?" "Well, we've been kind of visiting over here at the Mormon church." I said, "What?" About like Brother Frost, I said, "What?" I said, "What?" I said, "You what?" And they said, "Yeah, we've been visiting over there." They said that they knew you. So you know what I did? I made a visit to the Mormon church. And I told those elders, I said, "We can talk on the street, and we can be friends on the street, and we can talk as Americans if you want to, but you leave my people alone." And they said something, "You're not moving fast enough." No, I didn't do that. I just thought I'd throw that in there, just for good measure. But I didn't do that. But I'm just telling you, that's what John is saying. And that's what he's saying. Listen, John and Paul have some characteristics like this. And I'm about finished here. Let me just say this right here. Here's what he said. Paul used the word faith, hope, mercy, grace, and love. In his books, you know, grace and peace and grace from our grace and peace from our Father. That's how he started all of his books. He talked about faith. He talked about hope. He talked about mercy. He talked about grace. John, in the book of John, and also here in 1 John, he used the word light, he uses the word life, and he uses the word love. And if you look through it, you'll find out that light he uses here about 6 times, life 15 times, and love about 38 times. So John is talking about these things, the true light, the true life, and the true love. That's what he's talking about here in his book. And then he also uses the expression, you go through here and look at it, we know. I'm so glad we can know. I'm so glad we can know. It's not a if so, maybe so, hope so. It's we can know. And that's what John's saying. And also John's going back and said, from the beginning. He uses that word about 10 times here in his little epistles right here. From the beginning. In other words, John is about like us old people. Anybody ever been around old people? Leah, you're the only one in church that goes, can you tell me who the old people you've been around with? Of course, Leah, she takes care of older people sometimes. She watches over some people. Would you agree with me, Leah, that you know they may not remember anything that happened 5 minutes ago, but they can talk to you about something that happened 80 years ago? And when you're around old people, they seem to talk about from the beginning. You know, when I was born, I did this. When we were little, we did this. How many people remember? How many times have I heard the same story from the same old person 50 times? No, Larry, don't you point at Grace. No, don't you point at Grace. Larry tells me the same story all the time, and I'm sitting there. And when he's around somebody else, I said, Larry, is this going to be a 45-minute story? No, I'm going to make it short. He's going to tell us one day about some story that had three. He's had three stories, but he told us five. I said, do you know how to count? You said three, and he told us five. But us old people, you know what we like to do? All of us. I'm just kidding about Larry. But we like to talk about from the beginning, what it was like. I talk about it all the time when I first got saved and what God did and how the church was back then and how the church has transformed to what it is or not today. How the church is different today than what it was 50 years ago. And we love to talk about things like that. And so that's what John is saying. He said, I was there. I was there, I know. And I'm so glad we can sing that song, I know whom I have believed and am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I have committed unto him against that day. And that's our conviction. You know why? We know. We know. Sam's coming to the piano tonight. And while he's coming, this is what we're going to look at next couple of weeks, God's Little Children. And I kind of entitled this, Living at home where God is loved. You know, not every place God's loved. In this United States of America, he's not loved too much in this world. But the beginning of that life, the basis of that life, the betrayal of that life, the beauty of that life, the boundaries of that life, and the blessings. That's all right here in 1 John chapter 1, verse 1 to chapter 2, verse 24 through 29. Those things about God has given us life and the fellowship we can have with him. What I want to say tonight, let's be careful, little children, as John said here. Let's don't be overtaken by every false doctrine out there. Try the spirits to see if they're of God or not. Father, thank you for your blessings. Thank you for this time. And I pray, Lord, you just speak to hearts. And help us as a church, Lord, to be faithful to the word of God and to stand upon the principles of God's word and not deviate, not detour, and not let anyone discourage us in what we believe of who God is and who the Lord Jesus Christ is. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Lord bless you. Sam's going to play something. Lord bless you. We'll see you Wednesday night, 7:30. If you can come, we got something for everybody to do Wednesday night. Lord bless you. We'll see you then.